I'm Anne-Marie Michaels, and this is the Village Green Network TV channel, and this is our weekly Q&A. Put this out every Friday. Please subscribe to our channel so you can get updates. If you have questions, comment below, and you can also sign up for our weekly newsletter to get updates about when these go up, or our Facebook page. We post it on there as well. All right, what do we got today? This is from Crystal. She says, my three-year-old has a sensitivity to casein in milk. I'm on GAPS, the GAPS diet. I'll put a link. And would love for her to have the 24-hour fermented yogurt. Do you think there's casein in that? I'm asking you because I saw that you also cannot have casein. No, I can have casein. I have never had a problem with it. But I do know about this. Not all yogurts are the same, and yogurt that you buy at the store is usually only fermented for a few hours. So there's a huge difference in when you make your own yogurt or kefir and you ferment it at home. If you do ferment it at home, you're going to have almost no lactose in it, or none, no lactose, and no casein. Okay, so yes, 24 hour, if you will ferment your yogurt and your kefir for 24 hours, it should be free of these allergens that, because you have a GAPS kid, they're having trouble digesting. The deal with digesting these enzymes, there's nothing wrong with casein. There's nothing wrong with gluten. You hear a lot of people smack talking gluten and saying, oh, gluten's bad. No, it's not. There's nothing wrong with gluten. We've eaten gluten for thousands of years. We've eaten casein for thousands of years. These are not bad things. It's just because our digestion is compromised, because in this modern age, we've been negatively impacted by antibiotics, too much sugar, and other types of antibiotic drugs and vaccines. These things cause us to have problems digesting these foods. So, nothing wrong with them. But when you're in the mode of recovery and you're trying to recover, you need to avoid them, all right? So here's what I would do. Again, I'm not a doctor. I always have to say that I'm not a doctor. But what you can do is you can make a batch of the fermented yogurt or fermented kefir for 24 hours. I like kefir because it's really easy to do on your counter. You don't have to have a yogurt maker or anything. There's also certain types of yogurt, like Filmjölk, which is the Envili, I think, Vili. One's Swedish and one's Finnish. I can never remember. But they're also countertop yogurts. You can get the culture and just put milk in the culture and just do it on the counter, which is really nice. So if you will ferment those for at least 24 hours, what you can do is a skin test on your daughter, was it your daughter or son, I'm sorry, 3-year-old. Put some on the skin and see if you get a reaction. If you don't get a reaction on the skin, it's probably okay. It doesn't have the casein in it. Another thing that doesn't have casein in it, if you do it right, is ghee. So that's butter that you can, there's videos on this, I have a video somewhere, I'll see if I can link to it, how to make ghee. And if you make ghee, you take out all those solids, it's butter that's basically strained, cooked and strained, it won't have any casein or lactose in it as well. So that is something you can do, and do a skin test. See if you get any reaction. Wait a day, 2 days, 3 days, no reaction. Then what you do is take a little tiny bit and put it in the mouth and see what happens. No reaction, more. And even if you, if you don't know if you're allergic, this is a good way to test to see. Start with a skin test and then a little tiny bit of taste. What Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride recommends, from who created the DGAPS diet, she says that you should do this anyway. If your child is allergic to casein, you should start as small as possible, giving them a little taste, and you're going to be inoculating the gut with these foods. Starting out with kefir, you want them to start digesting these foods. If I had a dairy allergy, that's what I would be doing, because I don't want to live without dairy. I love dairy. I love cheese. I love butter. I love all these foods. So for me, I would want to start getting my body inoculated with these. But again, you have to go slow if you're, have the digestive issues, because your body just doesn't produce the enzymes, doesn't produce the bacteria that produces the enzymes to digest them. Now, if all you are is allergic to lactose, which I know you're not, but other people out there, you might want to try raw milk. A lot of people find, in fact, a vast majority of people find that they can drink raw milk and eat raw dairy, even if they're allergic. Why? Because raw dairy is not pasteurized. It does not kill off the bacteria, the good bacteria that produces the enzymes that helps you digest lactose. Is that right? Yeah. It doesn't kill off the bacteria that produces lactase. Lactase is the enzyme that will help you digest lactose. So, that's all I got to say. That's it. So hopefully that works. You might want to work with a practitioner to help you do that, but I think you could do it on your own. All right, I can do one more question on this video. So this question is from Chris and Heidi. And she, I think it's Heidi, maybe asks, congratulations on your pregnancy and Village Green. Thank you. And on my 40-pound weight loss last year, which I gained back, but I'll lose again. Thank you. I have a question about your blog post on your insomnia that you were able to cure through late night snacks and the help of Julia Ross. Julia Ross wrote The Mood Cure. I have had adrenal fatigue for a decade now, and just this last year was a perfect storm that tipped me into stage 3. Belly fat, insomnia, hypoglycemia, all day fatigue, and then the cursed 4 a.m. surge that makes me toss till 8 a.m. Working with a doctor and a nutritionist, and it's still not solved. I've been taking melatonin and nighttime herbs and magnesium for years, and about a month ago found Lactium and Phosphy. It knocks me out from 9 p.m. to 4 a.m., and then 4 a.m. comes, and there's nothing to shut the surge down, nothing. Until I read about maybe being fixed by a protein snack at 9 to 10 p.m., is this all it takes? It makes sense since I eat dinner at 7 p.m. and by 4 a.m. my body's hungry again. I would love to know if you sleep through the 4 a.m. now till 7 due to having a snack. Okay. It's a little different now because I'm pregnant, and so I have been waking up, but it's usually because I have to pee. I did overcome my insomnia. I think it was mostly a number of things. I did kind of follow Matt Stone's 180-degree health, I'll put a link, program, where I really rested for 6 months. This was a couple years ago, and I got a lot of flack from it online. People said, oh, you're fat, you're whatever. It's because you're eating gluten, whatever. I got people attacking me. But, I like to be transparent, and I like to share what I'm learning, and I like to try things. So I wanted to try to see if it would help. It did. For 6 months, I overate. I ate a lot, and I got off of low carb, and I ate lots of pancakes, and I was doing a baking class at the time, so I ate a lot of bread and hash browns and, all these kind of carby foods. And I also overate on purpose for a while, just to, I don't know, Matt's thing is like, Matt Stone says, you try to kind of really give your body all these comfort foods, and that would help with the adrenal exhaustion and hormonal issues. So I did that, but the biggest thing I did, I didn't exercise, except for, walking around kind of stuff. And then I got a lot of sleep. I slept probably 10 to 12 hours a night, which I wasn't used to doing. I was always used to sleeping maybe at the most 8 hours a night. But I would turn the TV off, put the lights down low as soon as it got dark, and really try to calm down. I like melatonin. I think that's a good idea too. But yeah, I would just try to get more sleep. Well, as a result, I did, my temperature normalized, stabilized at 98.6 after that 6 months. I did put on 10 or 20 pounds. Maybe not 20, maybe it's 10, I don't know. I don't remember, I have to go look it up. But I did put on weight, but it was worth it because my temperature stabilized and stayed solid instead of being always up and down with that, which you see with adrenal fatigue. And again, I'm not a doctor. I won't have to say that. But I did that and it really did make a difference because I did start sleeping through the night. So, you know, maybe you're not getting enough sleep. Another thing is you might be getting, excuse me, I have a breech baby and I'm like hiccuping. So what I would do is I would actually increase, again, not a doctor, I would increase magnesium. And I'll put the link to the magnesium supplement that I take. You can also take magnesium baths with Epsom salts or magnesium flakes. If you have fluoridated water, that's something you need to check out. Make sure that you're not getting fluoride because that does block magnesium absorption. If you want to take if you take Epsom salt baths, it will absorb, but if you've got fluoridated water, then you need to make sure that you block that fluoride absorption. So I would add bentonite clay to the water. I got that tip from Dr. Carolyn Dean, and I'll put the link to her book below. So increase magnesium. If you're not exercising, you might need to exercise more. That might help you sleep through the night. Exercise is not a bad thing. It's very good to be very active. I think that helped me too. After I did the Matt Stone plan, I did the Anne-Marie plan, which was getting a Fitbit last year and getting 10,000 steps a day, plus doing, you know, some other exercise a couple times a week, two or three times a week, whether it's weightlifting or spinning. And I slept through the night. But again, I made sure I ate a good dinner. I think it is a good idea. If you feel like you need it, have a snack before you go to bed. I always like a glass of milk before bed, warm milk especially. You could also do a little cheese and cracker or something like that. But if you're eating dinner early, you know, and you go to bed late, then you might need that snack. I know there's people who talk to about keeping some like salt and sugar next to your bed, like put sea salt and maybe some organic sugar together and then put that on your tongue when you wake up. I haven't ever tried that, but that might work. The other thing I've heard that helps with sleep is gelatin. So you might try getting some gelatin. I don't have any in front of me, but I'll put a link down below to gelatin that I like. There's one that mixes into any liquid, even your iced tea, and it'll mix into cold liquid. So that's something you might try. Again, you may just need to work with somebody on this. I know it's hard to find doctors who can really help, who understand this kind of stuff, but, you know, It can be adrenal exhaustion if you're testing positive on that. It can be that. It can just be that you are not sleeping enough or not exercising enough. It could be all kinds of things. So you really have to kind of work with it. But if you have to spend a few months, you know, sleeping a lot more than you think is necessary. 12 hours a night is a lot of sleep. And people thought I was crazy for sleeping that much. But that's what I needed. So do what works. That's all I got for this episode. Thanks for watching. Tune in next Friday and we'll have another Q&A. And please ask your questions.